Hello YouTube. Well, this is take 17 or 18, I think.
About that.
Yeah. And we're currently sat in front of you with numerous bruises on our heads from coming into contact with a microphone that's above us.
Yeah, you probably can't see it, but there's an enormous boom here attached to scaffolding.
Yeah. Anyway, you probably remember that I did a video some while ago with one of my friends called Les, and this is another one of my friends, Ben.
Hi.
And this time, no matter how much I fluff up the lines, we're not going to restart.
Okay.
Deal?
Yeah.
Cool. Now, one great thing about being around Ben is that the pair of us are sort of kindred writing spirits and can share a sense of humour, dark sense of humour, I have to add, that might be lost on other people. But, yeah, we have a good laugh, and especially in the darker sense of comedy, like bashing our heads on the microphones.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah, so far no fatalities, that's fine.
Yeah, just a loss of a few eyes, you know. Anyway, a number of people, Ben is from, like myself, an IT background, but pretty much people do some very interesting things in their spare time, and Ben goes a bit further than most, making films. And he even has a couple of dead bodies in the garage. I suppose before any of our viewers call 999, we'd better explain the dead bodies.
George and Gracie, yes. They're props from a film we did a few years ago called Underwood. And they're very, very, very good props. You know, utterly convincing looking props, which is wonderful. Though it did raise some eyebrows when people sort of encountered them accidentally. And at the moment, they're wrapped up in these rather shoddy looking black bin bags and tape. So if anyone does encounter them, it's almost certain to make the news.
Yeah, so hence I'm not... for those reasons of security, we're not saying Ben's last name or wherever he happens to live. So how did you get into film and writing?
I suppose I've been writing my whole life, really. Obviously not literally my whole life, but as long as I can remember, I've been writing things. And
yeah, I can just imagine the state of the inside of your mother's womb, scratch marks where you started.
God, that's disturbing. Yeah, but yes, it goes back to my entire childhood. But I didn't start writing for film until I got into watching films at film festivals. Started going to a horror film festival. I happened to have a deep love of the horror film, so I started going to this horror film festival in London called Frightfest, and I go every year. And it was after one of those films where, sitting down with a mate, we said we should make a short film to go into Fright Fest. And we made a short film, and it was awful. But in the process of getting it together, something very good came out of it, which is that someone I bumped into sort of randomly at a football match asked if he could do a making-of documentary of us making the film. And the documentary was vastly better than the film. And since then, pretty much, this guy Graham and I have worked on pretty much everything together.
Mm.
Yeah, so that's how it started.
So how long, how many shorts have you made?
Lots. I honestly couldn't give you a specific answer. I mean, it's probably 15 or 20, something like that now. Mm. It's that kind of number. Yeah. It's quite a few.
Could you convert your living room in some cases to a sound studio to do the sound dubbing?
Yeah. Yes, that's been done. In fact, a couple of them have been shot in my house. Yes, one in particular, one of our first ones we took seriously, was a film called Dead Cats Don't Count.
Dead Cats Don't Count.
Dead Cats Don't Count.
Okay.
Well, basically, this won't make sense to people. There's kind of an in-joke in there, because those fluffy microphone covers you put over some kinds of mics are known in the industry as dead cats.
Yeah.
And so Dead Cats Don't Count is kind of a satire on the stupid things that daytime TV reports on. And in this case, it's an extreme sport called cat stacking.
Okay.
Okay. So basically, the sport works like this. You take a cat and you stand it on 4 or 4 feet.
Yeah.
Okay. So a living cat, your basic cat... and then you take a second cat and you stand it on top of the first cat with all 4 feet planted.
Okay.
Okay. And as long as the two cats remain in that stack with all 4 feet planted in both cases for a few seconds, you score two, because obviously you score one for the first cat and two for the second, and then you keep stacking as high as you can. And it was about this guy who was going after the world record, because he's currently the joint world record holder with one. Because, as you might imagine, no one's actually ever been able to stack a second cat on top of a first cat. Because you're not allowed to drug them, you're not allowed to have dead cats. Dead cats don't count. You see, you're not allowed to use Velcro or glue or anything like that. So no one's ever quite managed it. And it was the sort of breathless anticipation of this person talking about this attempt for the world record, which once again ends in one.
Did anyone ever get disqualified for catnip?
No, there were. I seem to remember from the lines there were a couple of bits about, you know, people cheating with various different things, but and the our sort of hero, our chap who was attempting the record, went after a second cat and took a bit of a Siamese to the face. So when we saw him at the end, he had a bit of a scratch, but the. Yes, and his name, actually, the name of the character, which no one seems to get, is Joe Conrad, as in the author Joseph Conrad, which is an incredibly obscure reference, because when we were describing it, there's a very famous novel by Joseph Conrad called Heart of Darkness, and when we were describing it, I was trying to describe the character to the actor, and I said, well, he's like the Heart of Darkness. That's who he is. And so, accordingly, he the character ended up being Joe Conrad.
But you take all this stuff seriously. You've been to Cannes a few times as well, haven't you?
Lots of times, yes. Oh, I love Cannes. Cannes is very special.
Very special is one way of putting it.
Yes, you know, you eat, you drink, you attend parties, you see films, and you spend like 10 days talking about films with film people and doing nothing else. It's like you drop out of the world for a week and a half. And then when you re-emerge, everything's dull. Because it's much more exciting to be, you know, on the beach and in the hotels and in the pavilions. It's a brilliant experience.
Well, we know you spent some time drinking whiskey with Danny Glover.
Yes, well, we had a... As it's just the way this sort of worked out. On the same day that the British Pavilion was doing... Well, the Scottish contingent of the British Pavilion were doing this whiskey tasting at the back of the UK Pavilion in Cannes. As it happened, it was also the same... evening, same afternoon, that we bumped into Danny Glover on the back terrace of another pavilion. And yes, I mean, he was absolutely charming, has to be said. Absolutely charming and such a nice guy.
And so was the whiskey, I presume.
The whiskey was lovely, yes. Really, really nice. I will always remember the Ardbeg.
Yeah.
The Ardbeg was very, very good.
Have you bumped into any other famous characters?
Lots. Yes. I mean, actually too many to remember. I literally bumped into one. But we're not going to go into that because that's slightly embarrassing. Encountered lots of actors, lots of directors, people like that. I mean, for one thing, they're there giving talks and presentations and attending parties. I randomly bumped into John Landis there, having spent my entire life never meeting John Landis.
Yeah.
And then I think I saw him three times in the same year. Mm. And after a while, he actually started to recognise me. So, You know that look someone gets on their face where they're starting to think about restraining orders, that sort of thing. Yeah. So yes, that was a bit bizarre.
You also said that a particular group of English nutters attend Cannes in a van.
They do. They drive a van down from somewhere in this country, and they basically park it every night on the Croisette, which is the main sort of seafront street in Cannes.
Yeah.
And project short films in the back of it.
Mm.
So people can come along and just sit down and watch short films.
Yeah. How big is this van?
Not very big, it has to be said. It's sort of transit van sized. And they project in the back of it and you basically sit outside it. They project in the back of it.
Not screen. They project onto a screen rather than an LCD TV screen.
Absolutely, yeah.
Just to keep the authentic...
It's a film festival.
Yeah, very true. Yeah.
Yes, and then basically they set up chairs and what have you outside, or you can stand at the back and look at it. Yeah, it's madness, frankly, but they seem to enjoy it.
I might have said English nutters, but I mean British nutters, because I am Welsh and I don't want to include myself in the thing, so nobody can accuse me of, you know, I am self-deprecating, yada yada, please don't complain or complain in the comments, whatever the hell.
I think if you're Welsh, self-deprecating is the way to go.
Careful. You know where you shot Underwood.
Yes, yes. Underwood. This is our first feature film. We actually shot up the top of the Brecon Beacons in October. And while the scenery was beautiful and the shoot actually, I look back on as being something I'm very, very fond of. It was a thoroughly good experience. One thing I also remember is the fact that it was always cold and raining and windy and occasionally snowing or freezing or whatever. And on one particular occasion, we were shooting this scene literally on top of this mountain. I assume they're high enough to qualify as mountains. I never really know what
some of them are.
Yeah. But anyway, on top of this very large exposed bit of rock in the middle of Wales. And the wind must have been something like a force 8 or 9, something like that.
Pretty high.
And it was raining. So you imagine we've got a camera, it's quite a substantial camera like this, mounted on top of a tripod, which is now swathed in black bin bags in order to keep it dry.
Very high-tech protection, yeah.
Very high-tech. And we're standing there in the gale with a camera operator actually working the camera and two people holding onto the tripod legs to stop the camera blowing away and taking the camera operator with it. While the director is yelling instructions, and the only thing we can hear is the noise of that bin bag flapping around like mad because it's so windy. It's astonishing. Yes, yeah.
What the hell kind of scene was that? I take it you put music over the top of it.
Yes, I think there's music over it, and certainly we didn't use the original sound, I think it's fair to say. But that, yes, that was a scene in which our lead actress, Hannah, had to clamber out of the boot of a car in the open. She actually seemed much more comfortable inside the boot than outside, to be honest.
Can't we shoot the scene in reverse?
Yes. Yeah. No, if we'd done that, she'd have sprinted into the boot. Yes, there's also a weird moment, I think, just in the second shot to that, where if you look really closely, I think you can see an apple roll randomly into the shot. Because several of our people were sort of hiding behind some production vehicles playing Apple Splat, and one of the apples got away from them.
You might have to explain Apple Splat.
Oh, it's a game where you take a stick and an apple, and you splat.
Oh.
Those are the whole rules. There's no other rule.
Who wins? Who loses?
The apple loses pretty much all the time.
Yeah, so Underwood only took 2 weeks to film.
Yes, in fact, marginally less than that technically, because it was kind of 2 working weeks and a Saturday.
Yeah.
The majority of the crew got the Sunday off in the middle, but so it was essentially, whatever that is, 11 days.
Yeah, a feature film in 11 days.
Yeah. Yes, that was a very tough schedule.
They said that you were mad to attempt it. You succeeded, but you won't be re-attempting.
well, oddly, looking back on it, the schedule wasn't as troublesome as it could have been. Mm. We had to make a few compromises, but in fairness, we did get it all shot. I suppose the big problems we had with that were much more to do with just the compromises of having to move kit so rapidly and schedule things so rapidly, because you know you had to get a certain number of scenes shot in a day.
Yeah,
you couldn't just say, "Oh well, today's a bit miserable. We'll shoot a couple of the indoor scenes and then call it a day." You had to plough through, and that meant for our makeup artist, for example, if you were shooting indoor scenes that day, she might have to take the cast through, you know, 3/4 of the actual story in various different makeup setups and what have you, just so you could fill in as many scenes as you could. Which is extremely hard work.
After the film was finished, was your continuity person ever committed to an assignment?
Yes. Yes, that would be me, the continuity person. It's not strictly true. We had several people doing continuity of one kind or another.
Nothing like continuity in the continuity.
Exactly. No. And we tried very hard. I mean, there are a couple of glitches with things like mugs of tea and stuff you can spot if you know what you're doing. But for the most part, it worked. And it wasn't a... Given how much fun we had on set and how chaotic it was to do, it wasn't a bad experience at all.
And if you Google or do a search for Yahoo, whatever your favourite search engine is, Underwood film, you should get the website of the film. And among my amongst my most favourite of the still shots is pretty much most of the cast and crew standing there with the town sign of Underwood under their arm.
Yes, we had a weird moment with that because we needed a shot of a car coming down and entering Underwood.
Yeah.
So we had a fake Underwood sign on a pole, which we set up, and then the car comes down and goes past it, which is absolutely great. Anyway, we were doing between takes. Someone came along, pulled up sort of in front of the sign with his sat nav. He's sort of and then setting off in the other direction. You think, I wonder if he ever got to where he was going.
Yeah, because you also did some shooting in some in some of the shops and other things. I mean, not being a big name studio, how did people respond to you?
Well, I have to say, extremely well. We were in this tiny little Welsh village called Llangadog, and it's really, really beautiful countryside there. And basically what we'd done was taken out this really big holiday let house, taken it over ourselves. And then we were reliant, as you say, on local businesses, restaurants, shops, and in many cases the indulgence of the farmer down the road and what have you to make sure that everything worked. And overwhelmingly, everyone was extremely welcoming and extremely happy to see us there. And it was really, really easy to do. We did have one slight glitch. There was one morning we woke up and there'd been a bit of noise outside. We hadn't really thought anything of it. And we realised that overnight the farmer had come along with a big hedge trimming device and cut back all of the hedges along the road outside. So there would be no way of doing continuity between that, you know, before and after. And I can remember standing there with Graham looking at this, and he said, "We have finished everything we needed to do out here, haven't we?" "Yeah, I think so." But yes, I mean, in general, it was very, very successful.
Cool.
And there were many sheep. And Graham wanted to film the sheep, and then one day they all just went. There was suddenly no sheep to be found in Wales.
So you've got a current project you're working on. Tell us about that.
We've got a few that are sort of still unfinished. But we are essentially at the moment wrapping up our third feature film, which is called Isabel, and which is a sort of romantic French farce comedy thing, with a little bit of running around and lack of identity and lots of fun. And really right into my comfort zone when it comes to films, because it contains neither chainsaws nor cheerleaders. Yeah. So clearly it must be right up my alley. But the other thing that we're doing at the moment, which I'm still in the process of finishing the writing of, is we've got a sort of web TV series coming up, which I can't really say any more about than that. I'm afraid we're under NDA, but I've got that coming, and we have other bits on the go as well. I mean, Graham, my production partner, actually is also writing books at the moment, which I'm determined to do as well when I get in my copious free time. I'm going to do that because it's something again that goes back to just loving writing.
Yeah. Now we come from pretty much different writing, not ethoses. I'm pretty much writing book sort of material, whereas Ben's been writing scripts, and it was only in the script that we're working on that has currently gone to the BBC. That's how we did it was the story came out of me. I wrote the book, passed the chapter to Ben. As I was writing the next chapter, Ben was translating it into script, and that's pretty much how I learned to write script from Ben the hard way.
Yes, it's not the ideal way to do it. And for anyone who's now going to write in and say, "Oh, please, can you teach me how to write scripts?" No, I can't. For one thing, I'm no good at it. But for another thing, it is absolutely like pulling teeth trying to actually wrestle a script into shape. It is very hard work, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, how many years have we been working on that one? Four now? Five?
Oh, it must be at least four, yeah.
Well, we've been here five. We started this when I was in the other place. That makes it six.
Might be six, yeah.
Ouch.
Yeah.
And we still can't find anybody to buy the script. So yeah. If you...
Yes. Yes. Yes, and I still haven't found a taker for my stage play either. Much as they keep saying, you know, "Oh, yes, that's very interesting. We'll have a look at that." They then hand it back and say, "It's very dark. Very dark. We can't really do that one." And then they look for exits and run. So, you know, It's not always easy, is it?
And if I make, I have made mention in previous videos of someone teaching me horror. It's Ben.
yes, it's time we start with Val Luton, I think.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I've got to introduce you to the Luton bus.
The what?
The Luton bus.
The Van Luton bus?
No.
So you wait 6 months for you to come up with a horror film and then you come up with three all at once.
That's very good. Yeah, no, it Luton as in L-E-W-T-O-N.
Ah,
Val
right.
Luton. Val Luton. The Luton bus. Mm-hmm. Google the Luton bus, seriously.
Yeah. anything else you want to bring up other than breakfast?
No, super breakfast though, wasn't it? Wow. Oh, that was great.
Yeah, I know a few people have been following the Thursday breakfast, which I can't really do when Mum is here, but this morning's breakfast was bacon, eggs, mushroom and onions.
Yeah. Really super breakfast. Mm. And after a lovely steak last night as well.
Oh yeah, absolutely gorgeous. again, regular viewers might recall me talking about the Green Man. If you're ever a steak lover and you're in Sussex, look up the Green Man in Horsted Canes. Great steaks.
Mm. It is very, very good.
I would say to die for, but I'd rather walk out alive.
The beer's not that bad.
Yeah. I think we'll now call this a day, will we?
Excellent.
Yeah, I've got to do something because leaning down this is doing my back no favours. So, this is Ben. And I'll catch you on the next video of YouTube. Now I've got to somehow get out of this chair and press the stop button on the camera.